Well, this is where we're going to be exploring this morning. This is Fitzgerald Lake. 800 acres of conservation land. And we're going to be birding this morning. You can hear the birds in the background. It's about 7 in the morning. And we should have some good scenes today.
Again, many of you may already know Mike Locher from Hampshire Bird Club. You're the field trip organizer, that's what they call you. And longtime birder in this area, and he is going to take us away.
Yep, so my name is Mike Locher. If you have any questions about any birds in particular, but I know a few wildflowers, I know a few insects and amphibians, so if you have any questions about any of that, feel free to ask me. There are also a number of other very experienced birders on the trip. I recognize quite a few of you, but feel free to ask me if you hear something. If you haven't seen a bird that I mentioned, and you want to see it, let me know so that I can try to point it out to everybody. This is a really, really great time of year to go birding, particularly for small birds like warblers, which is kind of a focus for a trip like this. This will be prime time, and the warblers have really started to come in. Small numbers right now. I'm a little surprised with the warmth of the spring that we don't have a few more of the neotropical migrants, but nonetheless, they are here in small numbers. I heard that just yesterday somebody heard a black-throated green warbler, so as we go down the trail here, listen for a little zoo, 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 sort of a buzzy song from the woods. And one other bird that I'm hearing right now that would be a great one to see is a swamp sparrow, which is calling from over here in the marsh. It's a very, very slow trill. There's a, cue it up? No, it's not there right now. There's a faster trill over here, a chipping sparrow, which is very metallic, very rapid. But the swamp sparrow has a much slower, lazier trill to it. It's a very pretty sparrow. Anybody know what that sound we're hearing right now is?
Pine warbler, you hear?
It's very high-pitched. Brown-headed cowbird.
Well,
which is a nest parasite. So they don't create their own nests. They lay their eggs in the nests of other birds, including a number of endangered birds that we have around here, and then they abandon that, and their eggs tend to hatch first, and they will push the other nestlings out, and so a yellow warbler will be raising a brown-headed cowbird. They really spread a lot. They used to be tied to the Great Plains, basically, where herds of buffalo, bison would roam. That's how they got the name cowbird, and since they were always following the herds, feeding on whatever the herds would pick up, they couldn't stop and build a nest and sit there for a month and a half while their young fledged and actually became self-sufficient. So they would just lay their eggs in other birds' nests and move along with the herd, which is how they got their interesting habits. All right, let's head on down the trail and see what we can find. There's a call with three sort of down-slurred notes. Cheer, 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 and then kind of a jumble. I think that's a Louisiana water thrush, which like to be frequently along faster-moving streams.
Yeah.
There goes a nice red-winged blackbird displaying with his shoulders.
These boxes out here were put in by some state agency, which I've never really been able to track down, for wood ducks.
There's a red-winged blackbird in the scope, if anyone wants to have a look.
As far as I know, no wood duck has ever used these houses.
I know, there's a wood duck in a wood duck box.
Yeah, these were all designed for wood ducks.
Oh yeah, there's something sitting on the very top.
Yeah, I think it's another red-winged blackbird.
Yeah.
Well,
it's a twig.
Oh
yeah,
yeah.
Oh
yeah,
they are. Yeah,
did he fly away?
Fly away, yeah.
He scared
you. Scared.
I did. Oh my God.
Your fault.
What would you find?
The two chickadees are up here in the top of the pine tree and the little deciduous tree to the right. The two black-capped chickadees. They're the ones who are making the two-noted song. Drumming, just a very, very rapid series of taps on a tree, and that is their song. That is their mating song. They don't have much in the way, they have some calls, sort of a trill typically of some variety, but that's how they attract mates. They find a good branch that's old and dry and makes a big noise, and they will tap on it. There's some people who could actually tell you what kind of woodpecker that is based on the drumming, and I can't, with the exception of sapsuckers, which have a very distinctive syncopated pattern. I can't really tell the difference between the tapping of our woodpeckers, but they're out there looking for mates just like all the other birds. Song sparrow down here. And there's a song sparrow singing right over there. They often like wet areas like this, but song sparrows can be found anywhere. So if you come over where I am and look down toward the slightly greener reeds on the edge, the song sparrow's been kind of popping in and out of there. He's disappeared into the thicker underbrush at this point.
This is what he's on. He has to protect.
Yeah?
Exactly. He
they're
has some
very wary, boy. As soon as they see you, they're, you know.
You can hear the song sparrow's song coming from down here.
Yeah.
Sort of, they bob their tails as they fly, so it sort of gives them a squeaking motion to just go through the air.
No, it was like rain.
There's another Canada goose in the water up there, but I don't see anything else on the water. One Canada goose. Here's a song sparrow.
Oh.
There was a song sparrow.
That's typical, you know?
Yeah. Look. Oh.
All these, all the things that project out of the water were totally covered with turtles yesterday.
Oh, yeah, they were everywhere.
Yeah.
Hundreds of them.
Yeah, in the sun.
You know,
actually,
the lack of sun in the sun.
Ashley Pond, Ashley Reservoir, you know,
they were all over here too. Yeah.
This whole inlet. I don't know where they are. Eat. Where they just.
I was at Hadley Cove 2 days ago. Mm. And the water really has gone down. And I saw one painted turtle on the back of a big snapping turtle. And he probably sat on this thing and thought, oh, I'll just rest here. And then, oh no. Now
wow.
I can't move.
Wow.
It's a hermit thrush. The colors are really muted.
Yeah.
But if you look at the tail is a slightly different color than the rest of the bird.
Yeah.
Is the yellow-bellied sapsucker a kind of woodpecker?
It's a woodpecker.
Okay, I've always wondered about that.
Yep.
Yeah, and some of them will actually drill holes in trees, so that the sap will leak into those holes, and then they'll feed on the insects.
That is smart.
Our eastern sapsuckers don't tend to do it as much as the western ones do. See if I can find
They leave holes in the road.
Right, yeah, so certain kinds of trees, like apple trees, you'll see very, very orderly set of holes drilled there.
So, these are the sapsucker?
No, it's okay, Mark.
So what I saw was a female. It didn't have any red on the head. Much browner looking than a downy.
Yeah, sure. I believe it.
Which is right here.
So what are the common ones we have here?
Downy is by far the most common.
And the red ones?
A hairy woodpecker, slightly larger, but looks very much the same.
And all the red.
A red-bellied woodpecker is becoming increasingly common.
That's why I see it almost every day.
Yeah.
Red-headed, there are a couple of red-headed around Springfield.
All right, the sapsucker is up here in this tree. The shaggy bark tree right in front of me, if you go on the first main right-hand branch and follow it up, he is banging on a branch up there. So just go up that branch and look for some sort of movement. Now he's slow, not doing anything.
No, he's there.
Yes.
Yeah. But if you look at it, it's a much browner looking bird, more sort of speckly and streaky looking than downy woodpecker. That's a yellow-bellied sapsucker.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And for those of you who don't like the fact that red-bellied sapsuckers are called, or red-bellied woodpeckers are called red-bellied woodpeckers, you'll really dislike that these are called yellow-bellied sapsuckers. Is there anybody who hasn't found the sapsucker?
Yeah, me. I can't, still can't find it.
One branch
to the right, two branches to the right. The next branch going up to the right, which my laser can't get.
It's very visible right now.
Oh, God, that's killing my neck.
On that branch. So coming out at about 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock.
I follow the directions. I saw the green light, and I cannot find the bird.
And it's like almost
very
dark. Oh,
yeah, now I got him.
Yeah.
I was quite cornered about it.
Over on this tree. Is the other one still over here? Could be. I'm not sure. So
yeah, I got it.
There's a tree right down this direction.
Oh, yeah.
And pretty high. Yep. It's a little warbler. It's like a zebra of a warbler. Black and white streaks on it. Tends to feed along the trunk of a tree and along the larger branches of a tree, which is fairly unusual. Most warblers tend to be out in the leaves.
Actually, I see that. And he never stays still. So that's the song.
Yeah, that just it seems like a slightly unusual song.
A lot of people compare the song of the black and white to sort of a squeaky wheel going around.
Exactly. Yeah.
This one's got sort of a rising quality to it. It's kind of unusual. There are at least two of them in the area. There's one singing, there's a second one on a tree over here, and there was one over in this direction as well. So sort of scan for movement. They're moving fairly quickly, but scan for movement and see if you can get your binoculars on one.
Raising a ruckus.
Home warbler.
Oh, there we go.
If anybody wants to see an easier warbler on the neck, there's a palm warbler over here.
Okay.
Down. Two of them, actually. So, down here in this little muddy area, if you look down in the grass between the mud and the tree that's just to the left of the mud, there are two palm warblers. That's probably one of them that just flipped across.
There's one in the bush right in front of us.
There's one in the bush right in front of us. They've got a rusty cap, and they incessantly bob their tails. Oh, no. There's one that's way out on the mud. There's another one that's up in a small bush near the edge. Anyone not seeing the palm warblers? Anyone wants to look at it in the book just to compare what they were seeing?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Palm warbler has that rusty cap.
Mm-hmm.
And they bob that tail constantly.
At least four palm warblers.
There's another one across the way.
Yeah, the yellow-bellied saxophone.
All the rump warbler back there now. A large pine tree in this direction, fairly low in the branches. It's hopping around just to the left of the main trunk. Boy. Maybe you want to try to estimate how far up. A robin just flew in just above where the yellow rump warbler is. Yes, very close to the trunk. Yeah, now he's behind a branch for me, right in the middle of the trunk.
Yep. Oh, and I see the black and white warbler on the trunk.
Do you? Okay.
That sounded like a gnat catcher.
Hmm. And this got really high.
Yeah, I think right above us, tiny bird, right above me.
Oh, yeah.
There's a blue-gray gnat catcher. Now it's just flew, slightly better angle. Beside the trail, it's a light gray bird, very long tail, and a peevish little song.
There's another woodpecker coming. Yeah, that's the parasaps.
Actually, it looks like it's trying to get some spider webs, maybe for nesting material. Keeps flying up to that spider web, and I think it's actually stealing material for a nest.
Where is it now, Mike?
It flew off to the left. I lost it.
Going to get lost in the sun now.
Yeah. One blue-gray gnatcatcher.
Wow, they're really active.
Yeah, that's...
Well, I've seen them enlarging a hole in one of those trees back there, so I think they're nesting at least a pair. There may be more.
Oh, yeah, Blaze saw a hole back there, too.
There was a pileated woodpecker deep in the woods there. I just heard it one time, and it was quite distant. And this sounds like another gnatcatcher. Just here.
I can just barely hear something, but I wouldn't have.
It's not much to listen to.
Maybe around 1990, 1995, I think there's a lot of work done in the trail. But this is a little bit irregular. I remember working on another trail a few years ago, putting, you know, going off to the woods, finding stones,
yeah,
and putting them down. But these almost look like they're like a natural arrangement.
This, yeah. But yeah, there's a trail there that's like, obviously
yeah, there. I think somebody's killed them.
Yeah, other places. Yeah. Yeah. Clearly been laid.
Yeah.
And that trail looks older than the 1990s to me.
It could be. The I forget, the city actually acquired this property
I think
in the 1970s when Harold Fitzgerald was going to put a... owned this land. He put the dam in, and he was going to sell lakeside lots, so people could have lovely lakeside homes. And then the Wetlands, Federal Wetlands Act in the early 1970s made that impossible for him. Uh-huh. And I forget whether he sold it to the city at that point or a little bit later, but that was the first preserved section. It was about 140 acres around the lake. Uh-huh.
Now it's almost up to 900.
Almost, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe it's moved down the trail. I think I hear another.
What is that loud one?
It's a blue jay.
Oh, it says a blue jay?
Yep.
Just a blue jay.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, I see it. Yeah, that's the first of the year here. Cormorant down here.
Oh, really?
Oh, I think that's a sapsucker.
Uh-huh.
Because of that syncopated tapping.
Uh-huh.
It's a really loud sapsucker. One sapsucker, one song spell.
Oh, is that Cook's Meadow down in there?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's actually, we're looking at the big beaver marsh that's been fielded there.
Are they still around?
The beavers?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, very definitely.
This structure, this wire cage that you see over here at the was put into foil the beavers. It's taken quite a bit of work to actually foil them, although they seem to have stopped at least now.
The lake level has remained normal.
Yeah.
Yeah, that wire cage didn't go down far enough, and the beavers were able to get in underneath it.
Wow.
So last summer, we, by hand, we put 10 tons of trap rock all the way around the perimeter of that wire cage, you know, so we got trap rock piled like that. And it seems to have worked.
You get all wet?
They haven't figured out how to do that.
How did you get the trap rock down this far?
It was brought in by truck. It was initially 20 tons.
Let's go.
But we only needed to use 10 tons.
Okay.
They dumped it. They dumped it all right there. Right to the. You can still see a little bit of it right by the drain, but it's healed pretty much. Looked pretty awful after we got done.
Yeah, they're active all through this waterway. You know the. Watercourse.
Down throughout the swamp is a real beaver. What should I call it? Many, many households. And it's funny, there was one great big lodge that was active for a while, and then that was completely torn down. And they built other ones further downstream.
Turned down by
themselves.
It's a mystery.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, presumably by themselves.
I've heard of other predators trying to take apart these domes to get at them.
I mean, it could have, the water level had dropped, and it would have been more accessible. And I wonder if coyotes could have been industrious to pull apart a